peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Good morning and welcome to this Minster Church on this fourth Sunday after Trinity. Welcome indeed if you are joining us online. It's good to have you all with us as we gather to worship Almighty God. Let us pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. My sisters and brothers, as we prepare to celebrate the presence of Christ in word and sacrament, let us call to mind and confess our sins.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought, in word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Amen. Jeremiah spoke to the prophet Hananiah in the presence of the priests and all the people who were standing in the house of the Lord. And the prophet Jeremiah said, Amen, the Lord do so. May the Lord fulfill the words that you have prophesied, and bring back to this place from Babylon the vessels of the house of the Lord and all the exiles. But listen now to this word that I speak in your hearing and in the hearing of all the people. The prophets who preceded you and me from ancient times prophesied war, famine, and pestilence against many countries and great kingdoms. As for the prophet who prophesies peace, when the word of that prophet comes true, then it will be known that the Lord has truly sent the prophet. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Obedient from the heart to the form of teaching to which you were interested. having been set free from sin, I become a slave of righteousness. I'm speaking in human terms because of your natural limitations. Just as you once presented your members as slaves to impurity and to greater and greater iniquity, so now present your members as slaves to righteousness for sanctification. When you were slaves of sin, you were free in regard to righteousness. So what advantage did you then get from the things of which you are now ashamed? The end of those things is death. But now that you have been freed from sin and enslaved to God, the advantage you get is sanctification. The end is eternal life. But the wages of sin is death. Free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Gospel of this tension, this almost conflict. Jesus withdrew to the region of Tyre and Sidon. The Canaanite woman from that vicinity came to him, crying out, "Lord, Son of David, have mercy on me. My daughter is demon-possessed and suffering terribly." He answered, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of Israel." The woman came and knelt before him. "Lord, help me," she said. He replied, "It is not right to take the children's bread and throw it to the dogs." "Yes, it is, Lord," she said. "Even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table." And Jesus said to her, "Woman, you have great faith. Your request is granted." And her daughter was healed at that moment. Jesus speaks of himself as the Messiah of the Jews and of the Jews only. But he acts as the Saviour of the whole world. And throughout his earthly ministry, again and again, he brings life and health to people who are not his followers, not his race, from Roman soldiers to leaders of synagogues to women of doubtful reputations. This question, who is Jesus called to save, appears in different forms throughout church history from the very beginning, right down to Doncaster, Minster today. Are we here for us who belong to increase our faith? Or are we here for them, the people who don't belong, either to our group or to our church or to our faith? Is the church called to build up our faith, or to be an organisation that exists to help others? And I know this is a false dichotomy, but bear with me for a moment. So let me leap athletically over 2,000 years of church history to that conference in York. It's organised by the Save the Parish campaign. On the surface, it's about protecting the parish system of the Church of England. But underneath, the same fundamental question. What is the purpose of the Church of England? Do we exist to build up our faith, our personal faith, or the numbers of our faith, or to serve others? Do we exist for insiders or outsiders? Yes, it may be a false dichotomy, but it is a real question. It's about being Anglican. It's about who we are and why we're here. Here as opposed to a Roman Catholic church or a Baptist church or a Methodist church. But if you look at the rhetoric of the Church of England today, it's all about mission. Every diocese has a mission action plan. The church is being restructured and parishes merged in the name of mission. But under all that verbiage, and if you'll pardon the vernacular, it's actually about bums on seats. We must get people into the church. So the primary role, the primary purpose of the Church of England is to increase our own numbers, or at least to maintain the numbers. It's about enabling more people then to become us. Now, clearly, to state the obvious, if the church has no members, it can't do anything. To state the theologically obvious, we who have accepted the freely given glimpse of the love of God would be pretty selfish if we didn't want to share it with other people. But again, there's a question underlying that. Do we want to share that love of God for the sake of those who don't yet know it? Or to increase our numbers? And if you want to say very reasonably, it's not either or, it's both and, then what? Archbishop William Temple, of blessed memory, said the church is the only society that exists for the benefit of those who are not its members. I'm an Anglican because I believe that the Church of England is called and historically has followed the footsteps of Jesus to follow his commandments. Yes, to go out into the world to make disciples of all peoples, but also to do what he did, to show the love of God in down-to-earth, practical ways. When we feed the hungry, give a drink to the thirsty, welcome the stranger, clothe the ragged, visit the prisoner, then we are doing what Jesus told his followers to do. Then we are the hands of Christ on earth. The distinctively Anglican work of a parish church with its priests and its people is to serve the community in which it lives. The worship happens in the church, not just for the benefit of those that are there, it is a sign of the presence of God in his world for those who are not there, whether they realize it or not. And it is to strengthen us who are here to serve those who are not. It has been said that we should assess what we value, not value what we can assess. In Church of England terms, that means the value of a parish church is not judged by the easily counted bums on seats, but by the much more difficult metric of a church's service to its parish, the feeding, clothing, visiting, comforting stuff. That's impossible for statisticians to assess. One very concrete, close-to-home example. On a Tuesday morning, in this church, we have a service for the benefit of those of us who love the Book of Common Prayer. And we offer lunch to the social casualties of our city. Both are fulfilling the vocation of this church. Both are important. Both are following the footsteps of Jesus. But only one has the number of participants recorded in a book in the vestry for onward transmission to the diocese. If you are ever tempted to be concerned about the myriad of things that this church does in and for this city, which are not putting bums on seats on a Sunday morning, then just think of the number of people whose lives Jesus touched. And the gospel only gives us a very small selection of those people. At the end of his earthly ministry, all of his followers could fit into one upper room in Jerusalem. And yet here we are, 2,000 years later. The distinct aspect of an Anglican church is its responsibility for the geographical location in which it sits. In other words, its care for its community, its parish. The success of any Christian community cannot, indeed should not, be measured solely in statistics that can be reported to the diocese. Or put it another way, keep the faith and make sandwiches.
Let us declare our faith in God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Power of the Spirit and in union with Christ, let us pray to the Father.
Precious is your steadfast love, O God. All people may take refuge in the shadow of your wings. For with you is the fountain of life. In your light we see light. Holy God, Spirit of Consolation, hear us as we pray for your holy church here on earth. Grant to us the grace of your help and strengthen us in your service. We pray for the mission of this Minster church. Our clergy will faithfully administer the sacraments in your church, for our congregation and all who visit here. God of truth, help us to keep your law of love and to walk in ways of wisdom, that we may find true life in our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Bless those who are persecuted for their faith. Lord, in your mercy.
In your
honor. Faithful God, look with tenderness, love and compassion on our wounded world. Save us, Lord, from carelessness and blindness. In a world whose waters should refresh and whose oceans should cleanse, save us from wanton polluting. In our world where forests protect our air and wildlife, save us from the systems that drive us to destroy them. Save us from waste and greed. We hold up to all areas of conflict, deceit, mismanagement and greed. We're all drawn into the chaos of evil. We pray for peace among the nations. Continuing to pray for Ukraine and aggression from Russia, from Sudan, North Korea, Paris and many other places in distress. Have pity on prisoners, refugees and all who are in trouble. Lord, in your mercy. Sovereign God, give grace to us, our families, friends, and neighbours, that we may serve Christ and one another and love as he loves us. We Lord, look to those families who are affected by their children not attending classes at school pre-COVID, for their fears of the future for those whom they love. We hold up to you all who are dragged into poverty. We thank you for all who lovingly work in our schools, our nursing homes, hospitals, nurseries and prisons, also our emergency services. We hold up to you those who need such care and rely on others' help. Reconcile those who are in dispute and mend broken relationships, so that human love may be as a light to reveal the love of God. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Loving God, comfort and heal those who suffer in body, mind or spirit. We lift up to you those who are unwell at this time and have asked for our prayers. For Isabel Spade, Isabel Pacheco, Sheila, Christopher, Alan, Ben, Emily, Jean, Canon Christopher, Anne, Wendy, Lawrence, Janet, Sue, Monica, Judith and Howard, George and John. Give courage and hope in their troubles. Grant healing according to your holy will. Lord, in your mercy. Compassionate God, hear us as we remember those who have died in the faith of Christ and for those whose faith is known to you alone. Pray for the recently departed Paul Walker and Heather Taylor, and for Veronica Phillips and Walter Clark, whose anniversary occurs at this time. We pray for those who have died alone, unloved or unprepared. We pray for Nell, shot in Paris this week. For those murders that took place in Islington this week, and for those killed at Moldova Airport in a shooting. Bless and comfort those who mourn. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Give us grace to honour your call, rejoicing in the fellowship of our Lady Mary and all your saints. We commend ourselves and the whole of creation to your unfailing love. Merciful Father,
accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
We are the body of Christ. In the one Spirit we were all baptized into one body. Let us then pursue all that makes for peace and builds up our common life. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Thank you.
blessed be God, by whose grace creation is renewed, by whose blood heaven is opened, by whose mercy we offer our sacrifice of praise. Blessed be God forever. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
Father, we give you thanks and praise through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your living Word, through whom you have created all things, who was sent by you in your great goodness to be our Saviour. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he took flesh. As your Son, born of the Blessed Virgin, he lived on earth and went about among us. He opened wide his arms for us on the cross. He put an end to death by dying for us, and revealed the resurrection by rising to new life. So he fulfilled your will and won for you a holy people. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and singing. Same way after supper he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me."
mystery of faith. Perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of the Blessed Virgin Mary, Saint George, and all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever through Jesus Christ our Lord. By whom, and with whom, and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Amen. Let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread.
In our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies, we are not
that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us.
Eternal God, comfort of the afflicted and healer of the broken, you have fed us at the table of life and hope. Teach us the ways of gentleness and peace, that all the world may acknowledge the kingdom of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your grace and glory. Amen. Be seated, please. I have some sad news for some of you who will actually know Heather Taylor, member of this congregation, who hasn't been here for a number of years due to ill health. And sadly, Heather died over the last few days, so I'd ask you to hold her husband, Ralph, in your prayers, if you will, please. And also some other sad news. You will know Liz Dobbin, who worships with us, and her husband, John, who came occasionally, certainly in a wheelchair. Well, he is close to death too, so we're expecting that news over these next few days. So again, keep those two in your prayers as well, if you will, at this time, please. You will see that there's a choral evensong tonight, and if you're able to join us for that, it would be good to have you certainly here with us. It's a good way to end a Sunday, so come and join us. Then you will see on your weekly sheet that there is the Minster Choirs concert on this coming Thursday. So again, hopefully you've got it in your diary already, but if you haven't, make another mark and note of it and come and support our choirs for that if you can and are able to do us. And then one note for Saturday, it's our next coffee and company in the morning, and this is being prepared by the bell ringers. But again, come along and bring some friends for that on Saturday morning too, if you will. So we stand to sing our hymn.
Lord be with you.
The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Go in the peace of Christ.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.